Hey guys, what's up? So I hope you saw my first video on fiscal policy. Continuing with the series of fiscal policy, this is by me, that is Ayush Sanghi. As you know that I am a CA by background. I've taught at CSE study circles. And this initiative of making education free for all is a revolutionary initiative by An Academy. So we are making this quality accessible education for all of you. This is our Facebook URL, so you can write, like, comment, subscribe, anything that you would like us to do. Continuing with fiscal policy, understanding the concepts such as surplus and deficit. Surplus, what do we literally mean by surplus? Something which is in excess, something which is more. Whereas, what is deficit? Something which is less. It is not as much as it is required. So from fiscal policy point of view, we have two types of concepts as we discussed in the earlier part, revenue and expenditure. On the last working day of February at every single year, you may have seen that government declares a document which is loosely known as budget. As per the constitution, the same document is known as annual financial statement. What we quote in the annual financial statement are the expenditures as well as the revenues. So the revenues and expenditures are quoted in the annual financial statements. But there are times where the revenue might exceed the expenditure. So government's only source of revenue, that is taxes, and expenditure that the government is making for welfare, subsidies, etc. If the revenue is in excess of expenditure, it is known as surplus. But if the expenditure is in excess of revenue, it is known as deficit. So excess of expenditure over revenue results in deficit. On the basis of these basic meanings, we come to the budgetary allocations. So this is the code word that I've written over here, BDS, with respect to budget. So what is B stand for? B stands for budget or balanced budget. Balanced budget. What do we mean by balance? There is a balance in the budget, which means revenue is equal to expenditure. Whatever you earn, you are spending everything. There is no less or no more kind of scenario. It is a balanced budget. So in the case where government expenditure are exactly equal to the tax revenues, exactly equal to the tax revenues in a given year, the government is running a balanced budget for that year. So is that understood? That is a balanced budget. Second term is deficit. So budgetary deficit focuses upon when the government expenditure exceeds the government revenues. Expenditure more than the government revenues is known as a deficit situation. Kisi cheez ki kami hai, something is short, something is less. That is a budgetary deficit situation. And lastly is surplus. S for surplus. Budgetary surplus, when the government expenditures are less than revenues in a given year. The government is running a budget surplus for that year. So the budget surplus is the difference between tax revenues and government expenditures. So remember these three through this mnemonic, BDS, with respect to budget, balanced, surplus and deficit. Now, if we have to measure the budget deficit, what are the separate ways of measuring the budget deficit is the next question. We know that there is deficit, but how do we measure it? Kaise pata karte hain? We measure it on the basis of the kind of expenditures. So as we discussed in the last part or the first part of fiscal policy, there are certain expenditures such as revenue expenditures, certain are capital expenditures. So on the basis of type of expenditure, revenue and capital, we decide whether it is a revenue deficit or a fiscal deficit or a primary deficit. Primary deficit is only an extension to these two deficits. What we have to understand are revenue and fiscal deficit. Revenue and fiscal deficit. So what is revenue deficit? Let's understand. Revenue deficit refers to excess of government's revenue expenditure over revenue receipts. When the revenue expenditure exceeds revenue receipts, what we get is revenue deficit. Revenue deficit. So as you remember that revenue expenditures are the kind of expenditures which are day-to-day expenditures. Salaries, pensions, defense, etc. These are revenue expenditures. So all these kind of expenditures are considered to be useless expenditures. Why I say useless is that they don't add anything to our economy. So what is the implication on the Indian economy of revenue deficit? What is the implication? What does it imply? What effect does it have? Let's read this. Revenue deficit includes only such transactions that affect the current income and expenditure of the government. Only current. This year's income and this year's expenditure. So this year's expenditure would be running of parliament, payment of salaries, payment of pensions, etc. Only current income. When the government incurs a revenue deficit, it implies that the government is dis-saving. Government is dis-saving and is using up the savings of other sectors. So let's say in the year 2015-16, although this is not over, there was a revenue deficit, which means that revenue expenditure was greater than revenue receipts. So it means that expenditure is greater, receipts are less. So where do you get the excess money for meeting this expenditure? You get it from other sectors. You get it from the capital surplus. You get it from the capital surplus. So what is capital surplus? Capital receipts minus capital expenditure gives us capital surplus. This surplus is used to meet the expenditure, that is excess expenditure in terms of revenue. So dis-saving and is using up the savings of other sectors of the economy to finance a part of its consumption expenditure. One thing that you can add to this, that consumption expenditure for the current year, only for the current year. This situation means that the government will have to borrow, not only to finance its investment, but also its consumption requirements. As simple as that. If they have to meet their revenue expenditures, they have to borrow money. As simple as that. This will lead to a buildup of stock of debt and interest liabilities. So, kahan se borrow karoge aap? You will either take a loan or you will take the surplus of any other kind of expenditure, any kind of expenditure or revenue. So if you take a loan, it would add to the interest liabilities or it will add to the debt. Koi na koi udhar aapke upar chadega hi if you borrow. So this forces the government and eventually to cut the expenditures. In order to reduce this debt and interest liabilities, government cuts such revenue expenditures in order to match revenue receipts and not borrow. So government does not want to borrow, which is why it would cut its revenue expenditures. Since a major part of revenue expenditure is committed expenditure, this term you would come to hear in polity. So Roman that recorded a lecture in polity, it includes a concept by the name of charged expenditures. So the charged expenditures are committed. They are as per constitution, something which has to be done. Salaries of CAG, Comptroller and Auditor General, CVC, CEC, Supreme Court judges, running of the parliament, all these are committed expenditures. They cannot be reduced. Over and above, something that can be reduced has to be cut. So often the government reduces productive capital expenditure or welfare expenditure. As you know, we are a welfare state, so we spend lots and lots of money on welfare. MGNREGA, National Food Security Act, that too for 67% of the total population. So we spend a lot on welfare. We have to cut our expenditures from there. This would mean lower growth and adverse welfare implications. So as you know that we are a social state and a populist state, so this would have a negative bearing on the political party that has taken this measure. Coming to the second type of deficit, that is fiscal deficit. Now, mind you, we have done revenue deficit. The second type of expenditure that we did in the first part was capital expenditure, that was giving out of loans, long-term loans was capital expenditure, and receipt of loans or selling of any asset resulted into capital receipts. So if the capital expenditure exceeds capital receipts, it would result into something known as capital deficit, but there is no such term in economics such as capital deficit. So do not confuse something like capital deficit. Yes, there can be a surplus in capital account. There can be a surplus over here, which will be used to bridge the gap of revenue deficit, but there is no term as capital deficit. So do not use this term. I request you, do not even say this term. It would sound very absurd. Coming to the second deficit, fiscal deficit, very, very popular measure. You may have heard in the news hundreds of times. What is fiscal deficit? Fiscal deficit is the difference between the government's total expenditure and its total receipts excluding borrowings. So what is government's total expenditure? Total expenditure includes revenue expenditure plus capital expenditure. Total receipts include revenue receipts plus capital receipts. When we take the difference of the two, and if expenditure exceeds revenue, what we get is fiscal deficit. Fiscal deficit. So let's read the definition of gross fiscal deficit. It says total expenditure, which is revenue expenditure plus capital expenditure, minus revenue receipts plus non-debt creating capital receipts. Very, very important point. It's a five-star point. Non-debt creating capital receipts. Those receipts that do not create a debt. So for example, if the government takes a loan from IMF, World Bank, that is regarded as a capital receipt, but it creates debt. Ye udhar lag kar dega government ke upar. If it creates a debt, then it will not give a true picture. It will not give a true picture of the Indian economy. We can say we borrowed 1,000 million from the World Bank, and then we can say we have a huge fiscal surplus. But that is incorrect. That fiscal surplus is because of this excessive loan. You have to service this loan. Agle saal is pe interest pay karna padega. Wo kahan se laoge? Hence, we specifically exclude non-debt creating, we include only non-debt creating capital receipts, which is why we exclude debt creating capital receipt. Is that understood? Please remember this concept, very, very important for PT, and as well, an explanation could be asked in mains also. Non-debt creating capital receipts are those receipts which are not borrowings, so which are genuine receipts, jo aap deserve karte the. Therefore, they do not give rise to any kind of debt. Example, recovery of loans. You had given earlier loans and you recovered them. Proceeds from disinvestment in PSUs. ONGC has disinvested its 10% stake. So earlier, government held 100% stake. Now it has disinvested 10%. So 10% disinvestment in the share market would give out 10% share to the people and raise revenues for the government. So that is regarded as disinvestment. What are the implications? What does it imply? Let's see. The fiscal deficit is financed through borrowing. If there is fiscal deficit, we again borrow. This would again add a loan. This indicates that total borrowing requirements of the government from all sources. Wherever the government can, it will arrange sources from the borrowing. So let's see the sources from the financing side. The sources are net borrowing at home. What can you borrow from home? This is also known as indigenous borrowing. Indigenous borrowing matlab apne hi ghar ke logo se aap borrow kar rahe ho. Aur India ke ghar ke log kaun hai? Citizens, we people, the aspirants. We are paying so much. So we are the citizens and they borrow from us. Second, plus borrowing from RBI, Reserve Bank of India. And thirdly, borrowing from abroad, the agencies where World Bank, IMF play a important role. So these are the things that again give us the fiscal deficit. So whatever you have borrowed, you are financing your deficit from these sources. So these are the borrowing sources. Broadly remember all these sources for exam. Now net borrowing at home includes that directly borrowed from the public, as I told you, citizens of India, through debt instruments, for example, various small saving schemes, treasury bills, cash management bills, all the money market instruments that you know, they will be borrowed from there. And indirectly from the commercial banks through SLR. So SLR, as you know, we had discussed in monetary policy that SLR is for purchase of government securities. So when the government issues securities, it asks commercial banks to purchase. So they raise indirectly money from SLR. The gross fiscal deficit is the key variable in judging financial health of the public sector and the stability of the economy. So if the fiscal deficit is less, then you can say we are very, very healthy. We are stable. If the fiscal deficit is more, and to finance that excessive deficit, you are taking all the more loans, then it said that we are still unhealthy. Coming to the third form of deficit, that is known as primary deficit. Nothing new, only an extension to the earlier deficit. So primary deficit, please read, borrowing requirements of the government includes interest obligations on accumulated debt. So whatever government had borrowed earlier, it has to pay interest on that. That is regarded as interest on accumulated debt. The goal of measuring primary deficit is to focus on present fiscal imbalances. Now, whatever we had earlier, and we are paying interest on that, that wouldn't be a very proper measure. Hence, in order to calculate primary deficit, we deduct net interest liabilities from gross fiscal deficit, only to exclude the interest liabilities which would arise on accumulated debt. So if we have removed them, what we get is primary deficit. This is all the more true and fair view of the Indian economy, true and fair view. So now you can understand, you can even explain it to your friends, relatives, parents, whenever you read in the newspaper. So if somebody tells you revenue deficit, you can counter question him and ask for fiscal deficit. If someone tells you fiscal deficit, then counter question him and ask primary deficit. This is a very true measure that is used. So the primary deficit is used to obtain an estimate of borrowing on account of current expenditures exceeding revenues. It is simply fiscal deficit minus interest payments. Net interest liability is consist of interest payments minus interest receipts by government on net domestic lending. So whatever the government had lent to state governments, whatever it has received from them, difference with interest payments. So whatever we are taking net of that. Net of that. Next, if there is a deficit, if there is revenue deficit, if there is fiscal deficit, if there is primary deficit, then such kind of deficit has to be financed. What are the sources? We discussed one of the sources to be borrowing from various sources such as RBI, domestic borrowing, etc. So deficit is a practice in which a government spends more than it receives as revenue. We have discussed difference between the above is made up by borrowing or minting new funds. Let's see how. Although budget deficits may occur for numerous reasons, the term usually refers to conscious attempt to stimulate the economy by lowering tax rates or increasing government expenditures. So any kind of deficit can be overcome by making new funds available for the government to spend. So this would result in deficit financing. The best example is borrowings, etc. When you borrow, you are only trying to finance your deficit. That kind of borrowing and deficit financing will give, or it will stimulate the economy. How to finance such deficits? How do we do it? Budgetary deficits must be financed either through taxation, what they charge from us, people, citizens of India, from manufacturers, from industrialists, from everyone, taxation. Second is borrowing, loans from all three sources, RBI, citizens and international organizations, or printing money. No chapo. This is in the hands of RBI. It is the last resort. When nothing is left, then you print money. Otherwise, you do not print money. The reason for this, we will discuss in the chapter banking, why this is the last resort. So governments have mostly relied on borrowing, giving rise to what is called government debt. So if we keep on borrowing, it will add on to the government debt. Okay, we are able to finance our deficits right now. But what implication will it happen, which will it impact in future? How will it impact us in future, these excessive debts? So the concepts of debts and deficits are closely related. In order to bridge the deficit, we are using or we are adding debt. If we are adding debt, then how is this debt impacting our economy? Let's understand. Deficits can be thought of as flow which adds to the stock of debt. Loans ko add karte jate. If the government continues to borrow year after year, it leads to the accumulation of debt and the government has to pay more and more by way of interest. It will keep on paying interest if it keeps on adding debt to it. These interest payments themselves contribute to debt. So what you do is, in order, you take a loan, let's say, from first person. In order to repay him the loan, you take another loan from the second person. In order to repay him, you take a third loan from any other person. And not to forget the interest that is payable on this loan. So it is principal plus interest. So this gets a country or a government in a situation known as debt trap. Apne hi udhari ke jaal mein phas jate ho. Debt trap. So this is a very dangerous situation. In order to overcome, we have to finance our deficits from, not from borrowings, but from any other source. So let's see, is government debt beneficial for the economy or not? By borrowing, the government transfers the burden of reduced consumption on future generations. So future generations, our future generations will bear the burden of what the government is borrowing today. How will it bear? In the future, in order to pay that interest, government will recover that interest amount from our future generations in the form of high taxes, in the form of high inflation. So all these would result in adding burden on our future generations. This is because it borrows by issuing bonds to the people living at present, but may decide to pay off the bond some 20 years later by raising taxes. So biggest problem is our future generations have to bear higher form of taxes. These may be levied on the young population that have just entered the workforce, whose disposable income will go down and hence consumption. Thus, national savings would fall. So I've already discussed in my last video what disposable income is. Whatever you get from the employer, that is net salary after deduction of TDS minus personal income tax, will give us disposable income. Out of this disposable income, you consume plus you save. Consumption plus saving is happening from this. If this will be less, because personal income tax would be more, so automatically people would be, their satisfaction level would also be low and consumption would also fall. Consumption would fall, so national savings would fall and it would result into downside of the economy. The second is also the government borrowing from the people reduces savings available to the private sector. So whatever we save in our banks is given as loans to the private sector. If we are not saving much, then obviously private sector won't get much investments or much loans. To the extent that this reduces capital formation and growth, debt acts as a burden on future generations. Hence, we should not keep on adding the government debt. And as you know, unfortunately, we are only adding to the government debt by excessive borrowings. Bridge this, do not borrow it. Do not borrow. Borrowing is bad. It adds to our future generations' debt. Avoid this. So this was the second part. As we have discussed, spread the word of this education revolution. This was fiscal policy part 2, as we have discussed. An Academy. You know the name. So like, comment, and specially subscribe to this channel. Subscribe to this channel. You know all the links for hitting thumbs up. Facebook, this is the link. These are our Facebook URLs. These are our Twitter handles. Spread the education for revolution. And thank you so much for watching the tutorial. I'll be coming out with 1.3 fiscal policy very soon.